looked clean in their first game against G2, and it was a pretty one-sided affair. Already respect going towards Zeitnot, towards the AD carry position. And remember, he was a big part of where the success came from for the Supermassive squad.
And while they're paying respect to the bottom side, to the bottom lane of the enemy team, respect is also being paid to the bottom lane of G2 Esports, the Heimerdinger band saying, no, Hjarnan does not get to play the Donger. We're not allowing that one to happen today. They immediately get rid of that along with the Ryze. Tahm Kench, the second ban for G2.
Now, both Aatrox and the other really strong one, Urgot, have been left available, which is a good sign for G2. We heard from Mark about how they want to have Wonder on one of these carries, and I would love to see G2 now leave both open, which they have chosen to do. A lot of the big picks that caused them trouble last time around, things like the Tahm Kench, the Skarner, they have been taken off the board. So the direction which Supermassive take will have to be a different one. Things like the Alistar will rise in value along with the Varus as well, but instead they're just going to prioritize a strong top laner for Fab Fabulous.
Fab Fabulous grabbing that Aatrox early on here, and the response from G2, they're going to put Wonder on something with some firepower in the top lane this time around, making sure they've got the Urgot also picking up the Alistar for what did in the bottom.
So I wouldn't be surprised to see a Varus Braum come out right now for Supermassive. We could also potentially see the Morgana. This is something that Snowflower has played a decent amount during the regular season, and it often does pretty well into the Alistar as well, and would give you a little bit more lane power if Supermassive want to continue to rely on their very strong duo and the bot side of the map.
The Morgana is going to be locked in right there, making sure they've got that one. 20 more seconds before they can, before they have to lock in the next thing. So the AD carry pick still left up and available on the table. Like you already mentioned, the Varus is a possibility. They did pick it the last time these two teams met just 2 days ago, had a lot of success with it. Looks like they're thinking about some range, thinking about some laning power, but maybe just in a little bit of a different flavor this time around. The Caitlyn hover coming in. And locked
wow.
in, Supermassive.
All right, so our first Caitlyn of the World Championship will be coming out for Zeitnot. And if we already talked about lane-dominant champions, this is one of the most lane-dominant champions you can get down in the bot lane. Extremely long range, very obnoxious to deal with, and when paired up with a Morgana, you have so much pushing power. G2, they're just going to try to go for comfort. Hjarnan, he has played some Jhin during the regular season. Not that much, not really his go-to pick, but it looks like they're just trying to play the defensive option down towards the bot side of the map.
And as we get into the second part of the bans, we'll see how they want to target their opponents going forward. It's top laners and bottom laners picked up from both sides so far. So mid lane and jungle are the pools you're looking to pinch. Gragas banned out by G2, wanting to keep that one away from Supermassive. Remember, they already banned away the pick Supermassive used last time in the Skarner, and they want to disable more playmakers.
I feel like Supermassive should consider an Olaf ban right now, but they're still showing respect towards perks. Three of the four available bans have all gone towards that mid laner, and they are all big comfort picks for him as well. His champion pool is very deep, but G2 right now, I feel like they're looking at the Olaf. And if Supermassive choose not to ban it, I feel like the only option they have left is to go for that Trundle, who has been receiving a lot of nerfs over the recent patch. So G2 is saying, you know what, we're fine if you want to pick that Trundle, because we think the Olaf is a good matchup into it.
Supermassive with 10 seconds left to pick that last ban that they want to go with heading forward here. We'll see if it's the Olaf or something else. Maybe they want to target perks even further, and they will.
All right.
The Syndra ban there. 4 out of 5 bans from this Supermassive squad. Looking at that cannon in the mid lane that is perks for G2, the man that does so much heavy lifting. They want to try to make it so he's got a little bit harder of a job in front of him today, as the Olaf will be locked in for G2. We'll see now if Supermassive decide to go down that same line of thought that you brought up just a moment ago and head for the Trundle.
So I think that the Trundle is still a fine matchup into the Olaf, but right now Supermassive, they're lacking a little bit of engage. They're going to stick with it, so I feel like things are going the way in which G2 expected. The question is, what does GBM choose to blind pick? He's played a lot of Vladimir during the regular season, and it is kind of a safe blind pick in terms of it has a lot of decent matchups. I think this would be very ambitious to pick a Yasuo blind. I guess they're kind of saying that, you know what, perks, we think the only champion you've got left is something like an Aurelia. But all right, so they're going for a mid lane mage instead. I think this is a fine blind because with many of the bans already taken out, there are very few good answers from the side of G2.
Cassiopeia locked in for the side of Supermassive alongside that Trundle. Also worth pointing out that during the regular season in the TCL, Trundle was the most played champion for Stowmage with 9 plays on that one. So nerfs or not, he's familiar with it. The matchup is comfortable. G2 going to grab the Orianna for themselves there in the mid lane to go up against that Cassiopeia of GBM.
So I always get a little concerned when I see perks on Orianna. I feel like that when he's put on control mages, he doesn't have the same kind of impact that he often has when he's playing things like Assassins or Playmakers. That's not to say that he can't play the Orianna, but during the regular season of the EULCS, he didn't have the best of performances, often just getting hard camped. Now, against a Trundle and a Cassio, if they ever burn the flash of perks, it becomes so easy to just perma-camp that lane. You have the Miasma, you have the Trundle Pillar slow. There's so much setup to really punish this Orianna that I feel Supermassive have really tailored their draft towards shutting perks down, just like they did the first time that these two teams met.
And that first time that they met, remember, Perks was on one of those big hard carries. He was on the Akali, ultimately went 0-2-0 that game, wasn't able to find an avenue to really set those plays up and make things happen. And while 0-2-0 sounds like a score where he wasn't able to get himself involved in any of the kills, the entire squad of G2 only found one kill that game.
It was a very clean game from Supermassive, and my only issue with their draft right now is that they don't really have a huge amount of engage options. They have pretty strong laners with Aatrox up in the top lane. They have the Caitlyn Morgana down towards the bot. And they could do a very similar playstyle to what they did last time. Just play through bot, build that advantage, get a huge CS lead, take the early tower, and then use your faster mid-game spike due to the early advantages you gained to then force a couple fights. Just maintain pressure on the map. And you don't necessarily have to fight G2 at any point. Because remember last time you said it, Flowers, it was 5-1, the final score at the end of it.
So not a lot of blood.
We know Supermassive can play this clean macro style game. The question is, can they pull it off a second time round versus G2?
Well, if they do pull it off that second time round, they will lock in the first seed spot here in their group. However, the opportunity at that first spot will still remain open for G2 if they can find a victory here over the opponents that bested them just 2 days ago. We are on the Summoner's Rift here for the first time today, the final day of play-in group stages. We've already lost two teams from the other groups. Two more get eliminated today before we head into that knockout stage. Looks like nobody's willing to risk anything on this very critical game, doing anything too crazy at level one, so just gonna draw those battle lines there across the river.
And looking across some of the runes that have been picked up, for those that may not have seen it, Hail of Blades is being picked up for the Djinn. It gives you, it synergizes very nicely with the passive, right?
It makes you very,
super speedy,
very strong.
It means you hit pretty hard, and overall it's just a really nice combination with the champion. It was something that was seen a couple times in the West, down towards the bot side of the map, but it didn't really pick up any speed. It wasn't super popular, but now Hyannon making a bit of a return with the Hail of Blades.
On your screen right now, Perks. We've already talked so much about him during Champion Select. Again, you expect so much heavy lifting to be done by this guy throughout the course of the game. We'll see how that plays out at the top side. Some early back and forth between the top laners as they make their way into the lane. Fab Fabulous utilizing the power, that 1-2-3 part combo there. And as this game starts off, let's go ahead and I want to bring up here in just a moment a gold graph showing exactly how the first time these two teams met played out, because it was G2 that actually enjoyed slight advantages up throughout the early and early mid parts of the game, but around the time it hit 20 minutes into the game, a little bit after, Supermassive took control and never lost.
Exactly that, Flowers. And we really wanted to highlight how clean the game was from Supermassive, because initially G2, they got kind of small advantages in the top and the mid lane, kind of where you'd expect it, but Zeitnot was just building such a huge farm lead in the bot, and then the moment that first tower dropped, you started to see Supermassive gradually take control of the game. Every time Perks tried to go for a kill, the Zillion, the Skarn, and the Tahmkench all completely denied it. And what we saw was Supermassive taking clean, calm control of the game and resulted in a very one-sided victory.
A lot of that, I mean, we're talking about Supermassive and the strengths of this team, and you already mentioned how they showcase their ability to play macro, and a lot of the team's success, their ability to do so well, does come from the two guys on your screen right now, Zeitnot and Snowflower, just a power bot lane coming out of the side of this TCL representative. They make plays happen, they get things done. Zeitnot, quite an impressive player in his own right, can do plenty of things, especially in the early game. This guy really has the ability to get things going for this squad and make sure they have something to play around coming into mid.
Now we do have the jungler coming up towards the top side. Stonemage maybe looking for an early gank, trying to get Fabulous ahead on this Aatrox, but Jankos is around as well.
Yankos hanging around this area, low on mana, but does have the blue buff. Stonemage shows up first, instantly gonna get the flash out of Wonder, but now they're looking to go even further forward. Chains come out, pulls them back. But Yankos' presence there means that Supermassive won't go any further.
I like this from Supermassive, utilizing that they have a strong topside of the map with the Aatrox, and they want to try and gank it early. Wonder, he pushed a little bit far up in the lane, and they successfully punish it. So he now loses his flash, and Olaf wasn't in a position to counter gank fast enough. So Supermassive already getting that early pressure off, but now Yankos looking for a bit of a return gank topside.
Yeah, to be fair, Fab Fabulous also using flash there to try to go forward, secure that kill. He used it just a moment before they saw Yankos. They wanted to go for a potential turret dive there to find that last bit of damage and get the kill. But as soon as Yankos shows up, they have to back off. So that means both of these top laners now vulnerable without flash here for the next 5 minutes or so. We'll see if that warrants a return gank from either side, or if this is one of those games where you just see the junglers stop by at level 3 and then abandon top lane for the next 15 minutes.
Well, we'll keep track of where the junglers move. I'm still keeping my eyes on the bot lane as well, because remember, last time that these two bot laners met, Zeitnot had a pretty significant CS advantage over Kianen. He had the Tristana matchup into the Varus, and you kind of expect the Tristana to fall behind in that lane, but Zeitnot did a phenomenal job. 25 CS at 15 minutes, but G2 may be looking to shut him down early.
Thinking about coming down here. They saw them pop out of the fog of war for just a moment as they got themselves back, recognizing that those spidey senses tingling were not leading them astray. And it looks like they'll go ahead and send Snowflower back to base.
And the important stats to keep your eye on is look at how low the jungle proximity was for Zeitnot. 2.4% means that his jungler barely ever spent any time around this lane. They just built this lead by themselves. And it's really impressive to see that from these emerging regions, these kind of talents, many of the fans from Turkey kind of highlighted how strong Zeitnot and Snowflower were, how you needed to show respect towards the bot lane, and they demonstrated their skill the last time these two teams met.
G2 also taking for themselves now a very early Ocean Drake. 5.5 minutes into the game, Yankos taking advantage of the fact that Olaf is one of the champions very adept at soloing those down. He'll grab that for himself and his team, give them extra laning power. This early on into the game, the lanes are still going to be going for quite a ways now. See how well that pays off, how much of an advantage it gives them. Snowflower moving up towards enemy territory, finds a binding with some Tormented Soil down onto Yankos, but real worry about it there. Pops the Blast Cone, gets down that control ward, but Woodid will be aware of that. Just moving forward to clear it out here. Snowflower just being as annoying as possible.
Supermassive have a lot of control around the mid lane right now. Snowflower, he was able to get a very early roam off. He based well before Zeitnot did and was then already moving up towards GBM. Stonemage at the same time was claiming vision control around the top side of the river and was able to just steal away some of the camps from Yankos. So I like the way in which Supermassive are using this early pressure to just keep an eye on what Yankos is up to, where he's trying to path, and now they should keep an eye on. Okay, he's now towards the top side. Fab Fabulous needs to play a little bit more reserved, because the way in which G2 won the gauntlet was through early game dominance. And when you have an Olaf, an Urgot, a Jhin, if you can get these champions ahead in the early game, that can be a pretty scary situation for Supermassive. So they're doing their best to try and control G2 in this early game, where they can get to their mid game where Supermassive really excels.
And I think that's highlighted so much along with what you were talking about earlier with Supermassive and the fact that they don't have a ton of engage, right? If this team falls behind and they're forced to try to make a play, that's hard. If they're so far ahead, how are you going to run into a Pillar and a Miasma and some Caitlyn traps and a Binding and a Black Shield and all these tools? So much of this is going to depend on what condition they're in once they get to those team fight phases. And if G2 can keep themselves in a strong spot heading towards that point in the game. You can see both the junglers level 6 online now. Same story being told for the solo lanes in both sides. Bottom laners still not having those ultimates up and running except for Hjarnan, who does have the curtain call ready to go as Yankos has Wonder behind him, thinking about just trying to flex those muscles, move up a little bit, put some vision down in the enemy jungle. And I like this from G2, really trying to push their limits and see what they can find here as the second part of the buff, as the first buff rotations are going to come up again.
Exactly that. They know that Perks has push in mid. They've also had Wonder pushing in towards the top. I thought they might look for an invade onto the blue buff, but instead they're going to take the safe approach, just back away, have information as to when that blue buff gets taken, and have an idea of where Stonemage is on the map. You can see Hjarnan and Wadid doing much better this time around in the 2v2 compared to last time. The wave clear from Jhin offering a lot more value compared to the Tristana from last time, giving that extra bit of early power to help with the wave clear and also just get you through what can often be a rough laning phase again for Kid.
And speaking of waves and lanes and all these early game terms, you can see that the farm across the board, very, very similar everywhere around except for the mid lane, where Perks has built himself up about a 10 CS lead over his opponent. Could be a little bit larger than that, depending on how well he farms up these few extra minions that have built themselves up here in the mid lane, which is a good sign for G2. Again, as much farm as you can get on this guy, the better it's going to be. Allow him to make those plays in the mid game. You talked about his presence on a control mage versus something like an assassin or a playmaker, but Orianna does have that one ult, one game factor to her, where if you can hit a big ultimate, you can be that playmaker still, even if it's not the overall theme of the champion. As Wonder steps up into the enemy jungle, just sits down the ward there on the ramp towards the blue buff, Fab Fabulous. We'll find him walking back into the lane, but doesn't seem to want to go for that straight up one versus one. Just backs himself away now instead. As you can see, Perks getting himself back to base, wants to shop up and make sure that he's got the inventory ready to go for if a fight breaks out.
Now, we've talked a lot about what happened the last time the two teams met, some of the players that we wanted to highlight, but we've got to look at how this game is going to play out, some of the key win conditions that both teams will be looking for. And one of the big things for Supermassive is if you're drafting Caitlyn, one of the things you have to remember is that she kind of slumps outside of the laning phase. Around two items, she's not the strongest AD carry, and she's kind of that 3-4 item late-game AD carry where you can really utilize her range to take advantage of the fact that it can be difficult to get onto the back line. And if she's not dominating laning phase, then often you can struggle. Because one thing about Caitlyn is you kind of want to take the enemy tower by like the 10-minute mark, and then you start moving her around the map. Now, we are 10 minutes into the game. Zynot is dead even in farm with Tjarnan. So that's not the best start. Not the end of the world, but not the best. It's between ulti and mid.
GBM going to be pulled back by that shockwave. They're looking to go all the way underneath the turret. Looking to find this one. GBM taken very low at first blood over to G2 with the heal onto the Olaf to make sure he gets out okay. They get themselves on the board first.
Now, I wasn't expecting that play. When talking about G2, I thought that they would just want to try and limit the Caitlyn. And Jankos, he's just going to try and shut down Stonemage. But they just flash all in onto GBM and find themselves a kill. Now we see a trade in bot.
Bottom side, it's CC into CC, the binding into the trap to make sure they've got the damage. Two versus two, it's Supermassive coming up super big to find themselves one. Won't be able to grab the second one, but they will get the flash away. Wadid has no opportunity to do anything about this. The flash from Tjarnan, of course, Wadid's flash still working to come back on that Hex flash timer that he'll have, but man, that is something you can't give away for G2.
Exactly that, Flowers. Zynot and Snowflower. We were just talking about how this Caitlyn and Morgana, they want to be ahead in this laning phase. And G2's bot lane, they made a crucial mistake. They tried to fight for vision, and Tjarnan just eats every piece of crowd control that that duo had available to them. We start off with the replay in mid. GBM gets ulted in. He doesn't flash out the way because he doesn't think he needs to worry. He flashes then, but then the Olaf just goes for the dive. And even through the heal, he has more than enough damage. And then we see here, they get the push in bot, and they think, okay, we have control over mid. We can go and clear this vision out. But Snowflower lands a fantastic binding onto Tjarnan. That gets compared up with the trap as well. And because Wadid can't do anything onto Zynot to interrupt him, Tjarnan loses both his heal and flash and gives away a kill to the duo. So support bot lane once again coming up huge.
Three summoner spells down from G2 in the bottom lane on that one. Summoner spells also used by Snowflower, so it's a 3-for-2. Snowmage gonna find himself caught there by the shockwave. Does get away, Black Shield making sure no follow-up CC will connect, but that's also second elemental Drake of the game going the way of G2. Farming that one up almost exactly on timer to make sure they're collecting these neutral objectives, staying ahead in that metric of the game as well. Topside is one versus one. Fab Fabulous gets exhausted from that summoner spellbook, so we can't continue to fight, find any sort of a way to retaliate on that one right now. He'll just farm up underneath the turret.
And look at Perks. 30 CS up on his lane opponent. Orianna into Cassio is often considered a pretty good matchup for Orianna, and he started off with a pretty good CS lead, but now we see a fight down bot.
Did knocked over the wall. Gonna be taken somewhat low. It's Jankos going forward. Stasis coming out from Snowflower, trying to keep himself alive, but now the pillar's coming out too. They're looking to find the revenge kill onto Jankos. G2 looking to get themselves away on this one. Already gonna be losing their jungler though. Damage coming out from Tjarnan into the side, but Stonemage grabs the kill onto Wadid. It's 2-for-1. Going the way of Supermassive.
Wonder didn't have his teleport. He was forced to walk all the way down, which meant that Supermassive, even though they lost their support, had more members and had stronger members ready to go for the fight. G2, they get caught out of position. They lose two members, and that's Supermassive with a little bit more control over the map.
super massive, though, despite the fact that they're up in the kill. Remember, they're down in the Drakes, as I already mentioned, and the farm is also causing a gold disparity to still go the way of G2. The solo lanes are winning these farm wars rather handedly. 15 in the top lane, 25 to 30 in the mid lane. Bottom lane is going the way of Supermassive, but again, with what we talked about with Zeitnot, that is what you would expect, as Perks could be in some trouble here in the mid lane. Binding comes out. They are going to find some CC onto him. Black Shield down now onto Stone Mage. Pillar thrown out. Perks goes over the wall, keeps himself alive, and just walks on out.
But a greedy play there from Perks. He sticks around in the mid lane to get that extra wave of farm. And then Snowflower comes up to punish him. Now, this is where Snowflower just getting a bit of vision. He has the Caitlyn behind him, so he thinks he's safe. And a good binding onto Widir, along with a great stopwatch to just buy some time. Now, while the CC doesn't land, you invest a lot of resources from G2 just to get that single kill. Yanko's doesn't have the ulti anymore. Widir, he's too low to really tank up this damage, and he's still only level 6. And Perks had already used his Shockwave earlier, so he didn't really want to throw it out in that fight. So G2, they tried to force a fight that they weren't in a position to do, and then Supermassive successfully punished them. So, still a very close game. This is exactly what we want to be seeing between these two teams.
This is exactly what anybody wants to see when you get to see regions collide on the world stage. The best that those regions have to offer, just going head-to-head and just having that blow-for-blow sort of a contest. Top side as well, as you can see bottom now. Snowflower's in a lot of trouble. Doesn't look like he's gonna have much of a way out of this one. Damage coming through though. Supermassive looking to retaliate here. Maybe grab one in return. Won't do it though. Yankos putting in a lot of work on this Olaf today.
Port Morgana, the Black Shield and the ulti just isn't enough to deal with the ultimate from Yankos. He just ignores all that crowd control, runs down the Morgana who didn't have flash, and G2, they find themselves another kill and will actually be able to secure the bot lane Taren. This Caitlyn pressure, even though Zaynot and Snowflower have played this 2v2 extremely well, the addition of Yankos involved in these skirmishes down towards the bot side of the map has allowed G2 to reclaim control of the gold lead.
And that gold lead right now, specifically, I want to look again at Perks. 30 CS up right now. 15 minutes into the last time these two teams played, he was up 23. He's even further ahead than he was then, except then he was 0-2-0 at the end of the game. Right now, he's 1-0-1. Already has a better scoreline. His damage per minute was 306 in that game. Not exactly the greatest value, but let's take another look here at this play and how Yankos got himself another kill.
And this is just Yankos moving down towards the bot side of the map after having priority in the middle lane. G2 had the push in bot, and so that he's just trying to ward. He's just trying to do what supports are supposed to, and he ends up getting caught out. And unfortunately, as we said, there's not much you can do against an Olaf.
No,
with Ragnarok.
Not too much.
But I really want to echo your sentiment, right? The fact that Perks, he was put on the carry last game. He was given the Akali and Supermassive built to shut that down. They had the Zillion, they had the Time Kench, the Skarner was there too. Every time he tried to make a play, he got denied. And he baited his team into a fight that they just couldn't win. So Supermassive had full control. This time around, Perks gets a winning matchup with the Orianna. They put a couple resources into him as well. And now he's an extremely fed Ori, as G2 now looking once again for another skirmish.
Fed Ori, they've got a fed Olaf on the front line. Yankos has been doing quite a lot for this team, setting everything up so far. 100% kill participation, part of all three of those kills that the G2 lineup has picked up in the first 16 minutes of this game. 2,000 gold ahead as G2 now heads over into the Rift Herald pit with both tier one turrets down in the bottom lane. Neither team's really too concerned about leaving their duo lane down there, instead rotating them up towards the top side, where Supermassive does have their outer turret almost down. I saw a lot of people talking about this rematch between these two teams and saying one of the things they wanted to see from G2 was put Wonder on a carry, put Wonder on something that seems to fit his style better, and having him on this Urgot where he's got the CS lead, where he's almost got the turret down already, seems to be working in.
Yeah, Urgot is a big pick for Wonder. He loves this style of bruiser champion where he can really get into the thick of things now. G2 have started off the Rift Herald, and I have my eyes on where Wonder is. He's kind of sitting off in the shadows right now. Supermassive don't have full vision around this objective, so they're a little hesitant to just commit.
Supermassive also don't have a teleport on their top laner, who's still hanging out on the bottom side of the map, just around the red buff. This could be very bad for Supermassive if they get themselves caught out here. Stone Mage is going to be in a lot of trouble. Pulled back into the grinder! First kill of the team fight goes over to G2. They'll make it a double for the top laner.
And as you said, Fab Fabulous could not get into the fight. He did not have his teleport, and G2 were in full control of the river that forced the three members of Supermassive to funnel into this small choke point, and that made it extremely easy for G2 to shut them down. G2 find themselves three quick kills. We'll turn this into a tower and the Rift Herald as well.
Awesome play coming out there. G2 making sure they got everything they could out of that. When they get objectives, they get more objectives. They're going for, what's that, Vettius? More objectives right now as the Infernal Drake comes up and they grab a couple of kills to go with it. That entire sequence of events could not have been better for the EU LCS squad.
And props to Jankos, 1-1-4 right now. He's been involved in every single kill that has happened in the early game. And many European fans are looking at this G2 and thinking, right, in the Gauntlet, they won through getting an early lead and slowly taking control. And these are the kind of plays that get them those early leads.
Let's take a look at this Acer Predator replay to see how they got it all done again.
So you see on the minimap, Cassio forced out of the fight. Aatrox wasn't even involved either, but now Wonder in a 1v2.
Oh, bottom side. Wonder looking to make this happen, though. FabFabulous is going to be taken low. Wonder's trying to wait for the ultimate to run out. Doesn't want to allow him to find the revive. Shoots off the ulti. Not going to get it, though. Resurrection still going through, and Wonder fights them off. One versus two. Come at me, boys. This guy has no fear.
He chooses to use the ultimate extremely late, as you said, Flowers, to try and find that execute down onto FabFabulous, but he misses it. Good dodge there from Fab, and they're able to get the flash out from Wonder. He's now changed that to a heal, as the Supermassive members look to try and get onto Perks. Aren't quite able to do it. But Supermassive just trying to punish Wonder on a side lane, but he's reached that point on Urgot where he's more than happy to fight any contender that comes his way.
And for G2, this is a team that coming into the world's play-in stage, people had question about which G2 are we going to see? What kind of form is this team going to demonstrate for us? Is it going to be what we saw in the Gauntlet, or is it going to be more of what we saw of the shakiness of the regular season that had people scratching their heads a bit? Day one was a bit of a head-scratcher for a lot of European fans. Their first game against Supermassive, again, they got closed out quickly and cleanly. Their game against Ascension, they won it, but it wasn't in the way that a lot of people expected. They stayed relevant through gold leads, and then a Baron throw got them the win. And this team seems to have found more of that form that people were expecting here in their second day of competition in the play-in stage.
So far.
Again, we are only 20 minutes into the game. I will yield that. The gold graph that we saw earlier did showcase that in game number one that these two teams played against each other on that first day. It was Supermassive who was behind until about the 20-minute mark, but now Zeitnot has to get himself away from that rampaging Olaf. Good Black Shield to prevent follow-up CC finding its way onto him. No slows, and he'll get himself away. That's two ults down from the side of G2 as Supermassive continues to stay on the back foot, though. Rift Herald now summoned up in the mid lane, seeing if they can get some turret pressure on with this one. It's at half HP already, so one big Shelly charge might just take it down.
Ooh, we can see GBM coming in from the flank.
Turret destroyed, Shockwave down on the GBM. Can Supermassive find anything here? Flash into the Petrifying Gaze, looking to make the plays happen. Instead, it's going to be Cassio taking very low. Jankos already going to be killed as the Fear Beyond Death will find fear on multiple people. FabFabulous into the back line, still going to find the kill onto Perks. Shutdown over onto Wonder. Supermassive is able to find a few so far. Perks still getting himself away from the top side of the river as more damage comes out. The chain not finding its way onto Wadid. And it's one dead on the side of Supermassive, and two dead on the side of G2.
Big team fight win there for Supermassive. These are the kind of fights that they want to get themselves by punishing G2 for hard funneling onto Zeitnot. They were able to lock the G2 members in between a Cassio and a fantastic Trundle Pillar from Stonemage. This will result in the tier one tower in the mid lane going in Supermassive's favor, and they're slowly starting to close the gap between the two teams.
All right, let's take another look here how it starts with GBM in the flank.
So G2 initially commit onto Zeitnot, and you can see the Trundle Pillar and the Cassio, how they get locked into this small funnel, and it makes it so easy for Supermassive to just crunch down onto the G2 members who don't even have Jhin available. FabFabulous is zoning away Perks, who right now is their big damage dealer. And Supermassive, they just execute upon this perfectly, and they punish G2 for just over-committing.
And so much of that overcommitment from G2 was the expenditure of those ultimates.
Yes.
Now, for those of you at home who may not be familiar, Olaf without an ultimate very closely resembles a melee minion. He doesn't do a lot in a team fight. He throws an axe and says, all right, whoops, I'm done if he got CC'd. It's a very bad time for the champion. And we saw Jankos just essentially get thrown into the team fight blender in that last one. Couldn't really find any success the way he had in the previous fights, but G2 is still up 2,500 gold. G2 still has a massive CS lead in the mid lane. They've caught up in the bottom lane. The top lane is even, and they have the advantage in objectives, Vettius. It's 4 turrets to 2, it's 3 drakes to 0.
And for Supermassive, remember that when we talked about their win conditions early on in the game, what they wanted to do was try and get this Caitlyn far enough ahead that you can use her great siege power towards the mid game. You use an early game advantage and transition that well. But unfortunately, they couldn't quite get a big enough early lead, even though both Zynot and Snowflower played the lane extremely well. The bright side for Supermassive is they've now reached the mid game at only a 2,000 gold deficit, and they're really good at punishing mistakes. And you can see they keep trying to force these plays onto Snowflower and Zynot, and every time they get away with it. So you commit all these ultimates from G2 onto just a few members, and Supermassive come back and say, okay, now that you don't have those available, that's a window, we're going to look to come back towards you. And if they keep doing this, they can gradually close this gold gap and make the game that much more easy.
And Snowflower has been on point this game with Black Shields. I have seen this guy drop shield after shield with the proper timing. Never seems to be missing out on those. Perks going forward, looking to find some damage here onto Stonemage. Takes him, honestly, down to half HP with just a little bit of damage there from those abilities. Very strong in this Orianna. Binding comes out, finds its way onto Yankos, who, well, he stopped in his tracks. Unless you pop the Ragnarok, running up Morgana is not really a viable option, as G2 will now take the control that they found themselves over the game at this point, put some more wards down in Supermassive territory, control the area around the Baron, and we're at 24 minutes into the game, Vettius. Not too much longer, and we're going to get to the point where if Baron stays dark for too long, you can start a sneak.
I mean, you certainly can, or at the very least, you can start to pressure it, because remember, the thing about G2 is they know at this point in the game, they're stronger. Two-item Jhin, two-item Orianna, you have a level advantage over the enemy Cassio. The Yankos Olaf feels pretty tanky as well. And so you can just look to force a fight. Supermassive just want to mitigate that as much as possible, but they've gone for the dragon while G2 have started off the Baron.
Supermassive committing for that Infernal Drake. The pressure from G2 so far this game onto those Elemental Drakes has made them overcommit towards it, so we'll see if this ends up getting punished. G2 still in the Baron, gonna find that one for themselves, but now can they get the hell out of town in time? Wadid's gonna be the sacrificial lamb. He'll go down, GBM grabs the kill, but you still will take that for the side of G2. You lose your support, but it's Baron on the other four members.
More than happy to take that trade if you're G2 and Supermassive. They dropped the ball there. They saw all their vision in the top side get cleared out, and they thought, well, it's a Jhin, it's an Olaf. That's not gonna be the fastest Baron clear, but they committed 3 members down towards the Drake, and they only had 2 members just clearing the mid wave, and they didn't think to check it. That allowed G2 to secure that big objective, and now they can set it for the siege against Supermassive.
G2 with a 3,500 gold lead, with Baron up and running. What can they get out of it, though? Supermassive did at least stop that constant tide of Elemental Drakes going the way of G2, so if you can get away from this Baron push, maybe you win a big team fight, sort of just stall this one out, things may be okay. Picking up that Infernal Drake will be important as the game goes on, especially considering the third Infernal will be spawning as the final Elemental Drake this game. But for the next 2.5 minutes, things are very scary for a Supermassive fan right now. You've got to hope these guys can allocate their lane assignments correctly, set up to stop this G2 push, because Perks is so strong with the Luden's Echo into the Oblivion Orb, into the Spellbinder. He's got so much burst potential on this champion. If Snowflower's not there to protect people, especially with that Black Shield, he can immediately destroy someone.
He certainly can, and the rest of Supermassive are looking to target him. Perks, he does have Flash still.
Perks gets himself out, not too worried about it, doesn't even have to blow the summoner spell.
Yeah, he used the bonus movement speed from the Spellbinder as well to get out of that situation. Now, there's only Zeitnot for Wavekin. Now, he still hurts. He has completed his third item, but I don't know if he can stop this.
Yeah, 1 versus 3, he's not gonna hurt enough. The minions will take down the turret. Supermassive coming around from the side now, looking to find some sort of a punish here. Stonemage dropping down the pillar. Fat Fabulous wanting to go over the side, looking to find the CC here on this Aatrox. Gonna be knocked backwards by Wadid. Meanwhile, the pressure game continues. It's Perks in the top lane for G2 as Supermassive has to go back on the retreat. Now looking to find some sort of a counterattack onto the four members here. Rotating over now back to the top side. Perks will be their target. The cannon minion, the MVP of the push, making sure they get that turret down now as well. It's 2 inhibitor turrets down on the side of Supermassive, and they just seem scattered at the thought of this G2 push.
G2 playing split push Orianna. I'll be honest, flowers, that's definitely a new one, but it is working out nicely. Perks just drawing so much pressure and using the mobility that he has with the Spellbinder and the W to just escape any kind of collapse from Supermassive. G2 have now split across all three lanes. They have 45 seconds left on the Baron. Two exposed hip inhibitors that are looking to break apart the base of Supermassive.
G2 is looking like a team that wants that first seed. They must have tuned into the Analyst Desk segment talking about the strength of those other first seeds. You don't want to be stuck for playing versus one of those teams. G2 really stepping it up here on the second day. Looks totally different from what we saw on day number one. Really playing this macro game out with the Baron so well.
And we're also seeing Perks step up. We heard the analysts talking about it. We wanted to see a greater performance from the superstar of G2. He's now level 17 on the Orianna, two levels above GBM. 317 farm at 28 minutes into the game, 1-0-4. He has had a phenomenal performance so far in this game. And you think about what he did with only a single gank from Jankos. They secured the tower, he's zoned GBM from all control in the mid lane. And while Xehanort and Snowflyer, they have performed extremely well in the 2v2, we even saw them find kills in that lane, the pressure that Perks has been able to generate far outweighs that of the bot lane of Superman.
See if Ladid gets himself cut out hard enough here. CC coming through, damage also going in, keeping himself alive with that ultimate here for now. Chains come out, Ladid's gonna be brought down. They're looking to go after Perks, the Miasma goes down. The Petrifying Gaze also gonna be there, does not find the stun. However, Supermassive already got themselves one. Will they look for any more? Predator already gonna be used here by Jankos. Not really wanting to re-engage this one, 4 versus 5. But good lord, man, look at the Baron power play. 4,300 gold for G2 over the course of that one.
But Supermassive demonstrating once again that they are great at punishing your mistakes. Wadid slightly out of position immediately. Supermassive find a kill. Now they're sieging up towards the mid lane.
They're wanting to go even further. Chains down onto Wonder, gonna be bringing him back. There's a lot of damage potential still here in this Supermassive lineup, Vettius. They've still got 5 versus 4 for another second. But Perks is pushing down the top side. He's not here to defend against this Supermassive push, though. And it looks like Supermassive makes the call to back everybody else away.
Split push Orianna, ladies and gentlemen. Perks special, apparently, as he pushes the wave in. Supermassive, they secured themselves the tier 2 tower in the mid lane, but they didn't want to lose that inhibitor, so they will back away, and Perks successfully relieves the pressure from Supermassive. But again, Supermassive demonstrating that even with this deficit, they're willing to fight G2. They're willing to try and challenge the plays that G2 make. And with a 2-0-5 Caitlyn, with 3 items completed.
3.5,
the
man.
Four.
There's a last whisper in there.
Xehanort is still someone that you have to respect as you approach the later stages of the game. Supermassive still have that big win condition, and all you need is that one mistake from G2, and we know that G2 can make that mistake.
For Supermassive, talking about how Xehanort, again, is just such an important member of this team throughout their regular split in the TCL. He does almost 31% of this team's damage on average. They're used to putting faith in this guy. They're used to this being their heavy hitter. And as he starts to approach that in-game status, we'll see how that works out. Curtain call gonna be opened up here. Perks looking to potentially find the ball onto Xehanort. Not gonna get it there. Instead, it looks like the fight's just gonna sizzle out for now. Nothing too crazy happening. Instead, over the wall they go. Make a liar out of me. Why don't you? Fab Fabulous looking to start things off here. GBM's gonna be on the front line. Gonna be taken very low. Almost killed. Shut down now by Yarnet. Yanko's gonna be taken very low now. Next, Xehanort going on a killing spree. Grabbing that one. Wonder's also gonna drop a double kill over to Xehanort. It's 3 versus 3. Fab Fabulous into the front line. Perks still somehow alive. A double kill over to Yarnet as well. Supermassive fall back. And G2 head over to the Infernal Drake.
And even though G2 have a 7,000 goal lead, Supermassive go even in the team fight, and it is off the back of Xehanort in the back line. This Caitlyn is doing so much work for Supermassive, and if they want to find the win over G2, it will be Xehanort that will carry them there.
He's the hero of the day right now. TP flank coming in. Hjornan and Wadid caught out in the wrong place. Or are they actually? It's a rampage for Hjornan. The fight's turned on his head. A double kill for G2's AD carry. Get the hell out of our jungle.
And Supermassive think that they can find the flank onto Hjornan and Wadid. They were just sitting on vision, but Perks had time to go back to base. He shows up. He ends up being the hero of the duo, and they turn around the fight. They will secure an Infernal, and with 30-second death timers, they can make straight towards the Baron.
We praise the teamfight capability of Supermassive, but when they try to set up the play afterwards, they try to set up the flank and punish their opponents for sticking around too long, it all gets flipped on its head. That goes phenomenally for G2, who now onto the Baron in a 5v3. There's no way you can even contest this on a super massive. Write that off as a loss and get ready for Baron Defense 2 Electric Boogaloo.
Baron will be going down in favor of G2 Esports. The team that has struggled throughout the year, getting knocked out in the quarterfinals in playoffs. They're now in a position to find a win against Supermassive. And here it starts, Zaynok. He actually flashes on to try and find the kill for Perks, but look at his positioning. He's just sitting on the back line. And Shannon, he's no slouch either. He's landing some serious crits onto whoever is standing in his way. And if it weren't for him, this may have been a very different fight for G2, because Perks, he got zoned out almost immediately. He was forced to deal with Fabulous. And here, Supermassive, they know Shannon and Wadid are sitting in this brush. They're trying to set up a punish, but Supermassive don't expect Perks to get back that quickly, and with his arrival, they have more than enough damage to turn this in their favor, and Supermassive end up dropping, and now the Baron sits in the hands of G2.
In the first part of that fight, Zaytnot did 6,000 damage on the Caitlyn. In the follow-up part of the fight where they tried to find the collapse, he only got off 2 auto attacks. Not quite as much, and they're gonna need so much out of him. Lord Dominic's regards now completed. This could be Supermassive stand right here. Wadid's gonna be on the front line, soaking it up with the Alistar ulti. Big four-man pull. GBM's gonna be in some trouble getting himself away. Still gonna be stuck on the front line, taken down by the shockwave. Zaytnot still got free firing time, but G2's been able to find a couple already. Resurrection down to Fab Fabulous. Snowflower stuck in the stasis. Around the corner comes Yankos as Zaytnot has to get himself back over the wall to safety. Gets back with the 90 caliber net as Fab Fabulous retreats to the safety of the last remaining inhibitor turret. Wonders just crawling through the base, not a care in the world, but those shots are going to at least make him think twice about it. G2 with one dead on the enemy team in the mid lane, one dead in the support role, 2 total casualties for Supermassive. They've got the ability to now try to roll through here and knock down some inhibs. We'll see if they can find them. Fab Fabulous already back down to half HP. You can't go anywhere near Perks. He's so damn strong. The push onto the Nexus turret as number one's already gone. Stone Mage is going to be thrown into the grinder. Wonder makes sure they pick up that kill. With Sight not down, the game is done. G2 find their revenge for the first day. They'll find their revenge against Supermassive, and they'll go up 2-1 here in this group.
There it is.
Stop patting your stats.
G2 find the win. It was a hard-fought win. Those late-game fights, Zaytnot was making things difficult for them, but when they were in the jungle, when they were forced into that narrow choke point, it was the flank from Wonder that really turned things around. Being able to just walk into all 5 members, having that Urgot just sit in the middle of everyone, he caused devastation. And we see the difference in G2 when they are able to put Wonder on something he can have a little bit more of an impact on. When Yankos is able to make those early game plays, when Perks does what Perks does best, that's when we see the true power of G2. And while Supermassive fought hard, G2 were able to find themselves the win.
Supermassive played well, but this is what people were expecting from G2. This is what people were expecting from a team, from an organization that won 4 back-to-back-to-back-to-back EULCS champions, that has previously gone to Worlds, not through the play-in stage, but just as one of the higher representatives. This is the expectation of G2, and they lived up to it in this game. Now they've just got to continue pushing on throughout the rest of the day, because that first seed is now still within their grasp.
Exactly that. Now, if you assume